Good morning, guys. Welcome to another review with TC. What you're going to look at, what we're looking at today, is one of three non-premium tier 8 German tank destroyers that are in the game. We're looking at the JagPanther2. So this is the fast mobile. This is the fast mobile tier 8 German TD. We've got the slow heavily armoured Ferdi, which I've not currently got in my garage, as you can see, but I am grinding for it. And then we've got the sleek stealthy RHM. Recently acquired this because I'm on the road to the JagPanther Z100. Spent a lot of time thinking about it, and I think that definitely the JagPanther Z100 is the way forward for doing TD15. So the sooner I grind one of those out, the better. Plus, it's been in the game for donkey's years, and I should have had one anyway. So, might as well acquire one, eh, guys? I should have really started the review. I'm doing a mini series on the road to the JagPanther Z100. But I ground through the tier 7 so quickly that I haven't actually been able to save a replay because of the patch that came into the middle of the week. So let's run through the crew. You can see how I'm going to be setting this tank up. I do think it's going to be a keeper, this. Main reason being, if we quickly go to the tech tree, you'll see why. So let's just pop into the tech tree. So as we can see, from the JP2 that we've ground through, we can go to the Ferdi or the JP2. I went to the JagPanther2 because I could move the crew straight across. Now, if we look at the vehicle details here, as you can see in the crew, we have a 5-man crew. Commander, gunner, driver, radio operator, loader. If we look at the Ferdi, as we can see, the Ferdi has a commander, gunner, driver, radio operator, and loader. No, that's not the right one. I want this one. Thank you. There we go. So, commander, gunner, driver, radio operator, and two loaders. Sorry. Apologies there. Now, the next tank in the road is the Jagdtiger. If we look at the Jagdtiger, as you can see, the Jagdtiger has a commander, gunner, driver, radio operator, loader, and loader. So the crew from the Ferdi is a direct move into the Jagdtiger. And from the Jagdtiger, it's a direct move into the JagPanther Z100. So my thinking and the way I'm probably going to go is, I have decided, based on how this thing plays at the minute, I'm going to keep this. So this is going to be a keeper. So we're going to paint it, we're going to camo it up, we're going to, you know, we're going to put our emblems on it and things like that. So this will be a keeper, and the crew will develop as we go. And as you see, I've gone with a camo crew, and I've started training BIA as the second skill on the commander. So what I'm doing with the other crew is I'm training them as a repair crew. Now, you might say, why are you training them as a repair crew? That doesn't really make sense. Well, the way I see a lot of people playing JagPanther Z100s and Jagdtigers is as fixed as the same way I play my E3, as fixed case tank destroyer, as a fixed case heavy tank pushing forward, you know, what you call an assault tank. And so to do that, you're going to be up front, you're going to be, you know, you're taking hits, dishing hits, and as a result, you're going to be being tracked. So, hence, a damn good repair kit will be worth its weight in salt. As you've seen with my E3, it's like 4 or 5 seconds from being tracked to being repaired and on the way. And unless you're being shot by something like a Russian medium or something like that, there's very few tanks can keep you pinned in place. Unless it's an auto load, obviously. So it's, you know, having a good repair skill is worth its weight in gold for that kind of tank destroyer play. Whereas, you know, the JagPanther2, the way I'm finding I'm playing it, and as you'll see in the game here, is I'm playing it a little bit more sneaky, a little bit more passive aggressive. I know that sounds like a complete oxymoron, but I play it both ways and I enjoy it. It makes sense to me. You know, you guys, I know some of you guys that have occasionally watched my videos of Super Unicums and stuff like that, and you'll be tearing your hair out. But, you know, give me the advice. I'm always happy to listen. This is how I've chosen to go in this case. Nothing says I won't change it going down based on what you guys tell me. And I probably will do. I've gone with vents, rammer, and binoculars on this. I've not gone with a camo net or anything like that, or a gun lane drive or anything. The reason I've not gone with that is it aims in 2.1 seconds and it's got 0.33 dispersion, and I've now got a sub 10 second reload. Which, you know, means that my DPM has almost hit 3,000. With BIA, it will be over 3,000 DPM, which on a tier A, I think is pretty damn good, personally. Yours obviously will change and differ depending on how you see it, but I think that's pretty damn good, especially when you've got a shell here that does on average of 490 damage, and that the high wall can do 600. It's, you know, this is a really fearsome piece of kit. The gun traverse is pretty rubbish. You don't have a lot. You've got 10 degrees either side. The elevation's pretty good at 15. And the depression is surprisingly good at 6.5 degrees, so you can angle it back to improve this armor even more. Don't rely on the upper front plate. It's not fantastic, but the casement is actually quite thick and can bounce some shells, but don't rely on it 100%. Think of it more as a slightly more armoured Waffen RHM, but without the without the turret. So, you know, the camo bonus that you would have from a camo net is neglected because you're constantly moving the tank left to right to be able to get shots. So, yeah, that's my view. Yours will change, obviously. Gameplay you've got coming up is one we had again. Was it last night? Yeah, this was last night. Another great run of games last night. Don't know what happened, but the games were just flowing so beautifully. It's my ace tanker in the game as well, so really, really chuffed with that. It's just a really nice rounded game, I think. We did really well. We platooned with Sir Pete and Tanky from the fellow Philo people. Which is, it's always awesome to play with those guys. A lot of fun. A lot of fun doing this game. You'll see that there's some interesting comments from one of the players in our team. And you'll see throughout the game that I actually blacklist him as well, because I don't have time for players like him. But, you know, that's a separate gripe for a different rant. I'd also like some feedback, guys, as well. I want to do kind of like a weekly update, you know? I don't know what to call it. I don't know how I'm going to do it. But I want to do a weekly update for you as to where I'm at with grinds or anything new that's going on in the world and stuff like that. So, any ideas for stuff like that, give me a shout. Anyway, guys, we've waffled enough. Let's get the replay done. Let's get this tank in the game and let's show you what it can do. Sit back, because this one is a bit of a nail-biter. Okay, guys, here we go. As we can see, this is near perfect matchmaking. We are top tier on the Lakeville map. We'll speed up the replay to get through the countdown, as usual. So Pete's in his 54 mod 1, and Tanky is in his RHM. So we can see the different ways of playing these tanks. There's no scouts on the team, but there is a Cromwell on our team, and the opposition have a Rudy and a Hellcat. The reason I highlight those tanks is they are quite viable as scouts if you need them to be. So initially, as you can see, not that slow, you know, straight off heading into the town location. There's me, Sir Pete, the AMX, the IS-2 and the 34-1. Yeah, our Tiger-2 says things. I don't know what. Bit of jostling. So we're just pushing into town here on the 8-9 side of the Lakeville map. The 34-1 is ahead of us. Tank is in the middle. Looking for targets at the minute. The Cromwell's taken the really good spot with the VK. They've got a really good view range, so they're going to give us eyes across that middle, which hopefully should mean we can get shots into things. But currently, it's just us pushing into town really aggressively here. I want to draw attention to the position of our super perishing. If you look on the minimap, you know, camps back on the D line. There are he starts the game fantastically by taking out one of our tanks. I have to pause my manoeuvres there for the 34-1. He's taking quite a brave line here. I stop here looking for shots on that corner, but currently we can't see anything. Nothing gets spotted by the 34-1. And then suddenly, boom, a big old ho-ho. So the ho-ho has done totally the right thing. He's coming to town, he's here to defend and cause trouble. There's an IS-2, there's Pete. We're fairly confident if this guy's on his own, we can just rip him to shreds. You know, big hits there onto him. Auto aim round the corner, 466 into him. And I decide I'm going to hug him slightly to stop him turning. I'm trying to push him a little bit, but reloaded. Pop straight into the side of him. Looking for shots on the prototype, we're nearly loaded again. Now we do have shots clean at the front of the prototype, however, as you'll see, we go for the side shot, but then we donk it straight into his front of a plate. Trying to side scrape a little bit. Keep rocking backwards and forwards here. And then we decide, yeah, right, okay. Looking for shots on the SU-100 there, but we can't see him. So I tell Pete, right, I'm going for the prototype. But first, we take out the SU-100. Pushing in on the prototype. Prototype rips our track off. Now with the rate of fire this thing has, I don't want to get stopped by him. So I'm then circle strafing a prototype who's all crossed up and nowhere to go except back to the garage. So that was a really lucky gameplay. It's at this point we notice that the flank on the 1-2 line has gone. So I tell Pete, right, I'm going to go back. I've loaded a HE shell, but I don't know why I loaded a HE shell. I think it was just a decap, just to, you know, so we can decap. But screeching back to the base as quickly as I can do now. I did tab out and tab back in, so I wasted the HE shell, so I've no HE left now. And I'm onto just AP. So we're pushing back along the flank. Pete's come with me. We've left the Dick and Max in position. And we've come back to defend the base. As you can see, because we're such a quick and mobile TD, we've been able to do that with ease. You know, we've gone all the way to the other side of the map, and now we've come all the way back to defend the base. There's very few other tank destroyers would have the mobility to be able to do this and bring such potent firepower back to base. Tanky's running the 150mm derp gun. So he has a 17 second reload, but he does do a lot of damage when he hits. I'm looking for shots from back here at range. Main reason being, the further away I am, the more effective my armour is. Looking for shots, nothing here. Side of a T-29. Unfortunately, the shell's not quick enough, so we missed. Tanky lands a smooth hit there and sets him on fire. We're not in a great position to shoot this IS, unfortunately. So I'm looking in the middle because it suddenly dawns on me that, you know, we're going to have tanks pushing through the middle and I don't want to get ambushed by them. So Pete's rushing across the open gap here to help Tanky. And I choose to sit back and there we go. There's the RHM. Big hit, takes his tracks. Pull back around the corner because we have been spotted, so we just let ourselves get unspotted. Knock the tree down to fake going up the hill in case anybody's watching. Then we pull back around. We have the slimmest of shots because he angles. But luckily, German precision, we're able to take him out. Now, I want to start pushing across here, but as I do so, you'll see what happens. Pull around the corner. I'm looking across here because I'm looking for where the JP2 was. there's the JagPanther2. And then suddenly the SU-122-44 takes out the Dicker, so straight away that puts me on the defensive. Somewhere on that middle road is a 122-44. Now that thing, as you've seen from previous games, has a ferocious rate of fire and a huge amount of DPM. The Hellcat and the T-25 for the opposition have relocated and are now in the valley fighting Sir Pete and the Super Pershing. It's me and the AMX over here. We've got a JP-2 and we've got an SU-122-44. So we're holding location until we get eyes and knowledge on where they are. Tanky's taking a standoff supporting role there to help Sir Pete. He's a bit static here because we're kind of just, you know, I don't want to say indecisive, but we are a bit indecisive. I'm kind of trying to decide what is the best course of action. Do I take a hit from the SU and go for the JP2? Or not? You know, that JP2 could be anywhere in the maze of buildings and roads in front of us. It could even be coming up on our flank, so, you know, we don't know where he is. I'm on 4 kills. I'm having quite a good game. I'm quite happy. I keep trying to use the cover, but then we spot the JagPanther. It bounces off us. We snap a great shell into him, which means that the AMX can push in, but we take a huge hit from the rear, from the SU-122, and we just can't see him. Because we can't see him, you know, we don't know where he is when he pulled that shot. He could be anywhere on that middle road. And I'm now down to 215 hit points, so I'm now a one shot. I'm pinging the middle there to let Tank, you know, he's there, he's gotta be. And, you know, I'm knocking buildings down. I'm doing everything wrong at this point because of that 122-54. I should slow the gameplay down, I should be a little bit more cautious. You probably can't see because he's on my, because I've added him to my blacklist, but our Super Perishing at this point is just raging at everybody and calling us noobs and bots and things like that, you know. So, GG, well played to you, sir. You had a very impactful game. Child red line sniping from all the way back here and then going defending a base. Looking for shots in the middle, just hoping to see a thing. Tanky starts to push up the valley, and unfortunately I should have noticed this a lot sooner when we were playing the game, because I should have been making my push down the fall line now. Instead, I'm sat here waiting. It's a very stagnant point in the game. The AMX has pushed round. So, yeah, there's 3 tanks left. All 3 of them just have to look at me to kill me. I see the SU has relocated. Tanky lands a shot, but unfortunately gets arted. I've still not moved. I've still held my location. You know, I should have been going down that fall line to support Tanky. I would have been able to get round the back, you know. And here we go, here's the Super P. He's you know, I'm a little bit harsh with my comment back to him there. But, you know, people like that just annoy me. So the AMX is saying I've been spotted, I think. I don't know. These people running these Russian mod packs, while they're really good and everything, I've got nothing wrong with them, I just don't speak Russian, so I don't know what he's saying. All I got was help. So, pushing down the midline, as you can see, because we're quick and mobile, we've been able to relocate from one end of the map to the other in a fairly short speed. And as we pop around the corner, we managed to get a very lucky spot here. Scumbag spotted. Back to the garage with you, heathen. So the AMX is still slowly making his way up. Pete's pinging where the AMX needs to be. And the AMX is saying, no, you need to cap. And it's like, you know, and I'm thinking, I don't really want to cap against an SU, because if I don't bounce his shell, you know. And again, the super piece that's spamming the map, so very shortly, I just have enough of this guy. I just put him on the blacklist. I don't need the spam, I need to be able to concentrate. If I can give you any advice, guys, really, if you start behaving like this guy in this super position, you are not helping your team. Spamming the map and, you know, constantly pinging it for people is just going to annoy them, and it's just going to distract them from the game in hand. You're trying to win the game. You know, you're trying to outthink and outplan what this guy is doing in this very dangerous tier 7 tank destroyer. You know, yeah, it's great you're trying to help, but all you're doing is distracting the players from what they are trying to do. After discussion with Pete and Tanky, decide, yeah, let's sit in the cat, let's put some pressure. So I sit just outside the white line initially. You know, the warning comes on, and I've got to get in the cap in the next couple of seconds to win this game. So that's what I do. Into the cap. The arty's put the shot in, so I know I've got about 40 seconds. There's the SU. He is a one shot. So I've literally just got to wait for this guy. Because the arty's already fired, I know I'm safe for at least another 30 seconds. This guy has to make the move to decap. Alright, he puts a shot in, and then he pulls forward. Bang! We get the kill shot. AMX is really helpful, they're saying, look, he's in that corner. So it's like, right, okay, got it. So I head off as if I'm going to come around the back. Then I peel up here. As we get here, bingo, there he is, and he's looking this way. So it's a case of, how can I take this guy out? Should I come down on top of him? Nope, he's going to shoot us straight away. And, you know, the countdown timer is in my ear ringing at this point, and it's like, I've got to do something. And it's like, right, screw it. Penny, pound, go. We get around the back of him, and then he's never going to outturn a JP2. We turn in. Kill number 7, game secured. Sorry, Artie. My kill. The AMX there is really kind of good. Gives us a GG in game, which is a lot of value. Really, really well worth. Anyway, guys, that's been this replay. You know, we should. That gameplay there, let's go to the post game stats, though. Right, guys, post game. Mastery badge, as we said. Bruiser. Duelist, Fire for Effect, High Caliber, Top Gun, 54,639 credits with 3,980 XP. I was running some credit bonuses last night to aid the grind on this, so that's why that's so inflated. Team score, as you can see, 3,781 damage. It's a little of 1,800 more than the next person on the team. 1,600 more than the next person on the team, so really nice showing for the JagPanther2 there. 1,263 base experience, so even without the bonuses and everything, it's a really good game in terms of your base XP. We fired 14, 12 hit, 11 penetrated. Very unlucky shot on the T28 prototype, should have aimed it better. Managed to block 1,070 with the armor, so as you can see, it does work from range. And we got 660 assistance damage. Because we burnt a big repair kit, we only made 3,685 credits, but we did turn a profit, and that's really important to turn a profit. We would have made 1,894 experience with our premium account. However, because we got the personal reserve running that doubles it, and because we were playing in a tier 8 platoon as well, we got a bit extra. So that's what bumps up our experience in this game. So what you saw in that game, in my opinion, is some of the benefits of the JP2. It's a very brutal machine. It's very quick. It's very punchy. It gets in there. It gets the job done. However, you've also got to remember that you are one of the quicker TDs in the game, and you can relocate around the place massively, 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 and just continually, you know, pop up in different locations. Use the speed, use the mobility. That's what it's there for. You know, there are certain parts of this game I was a little bit campy, I was a little passive. I should have been more in tune with what my platoon mates were doing. When Tanky pushed the middle, should have been there to back him up. You know, should have been going down that middle road, ready to back him up, and, you know, possibly save the AMX as well. You know, there are a few holes in that game that I can pick at all day, but overall, I'm very happy with it. And a Mastery Badge game is nothing to be sniffed at. The other thing I've just noticed as well is I'm nearly halfway there on the damage for the TD15 mission, so things are looking very well for the JagPanther2 being able to do that. If I'm doing this already at just a tier 8. So, fingers crossed. Anyway, guys, JagPanther2, we're on the road to the JagPanther2. We'll get there, and then hopefully that 260 will be in the garage as well. Anyway, thanks very much for watching, guys. Hopefully you enjoyed. Smash the like button, smash the subscribe button if you think it's worthy of it, and we'll catch you on the next replay. Thanks very much, guys, and have a good evening. Bye now.